happen, we have to really escalate the noise we make so that we'll be heard.
Everybody, welcome to Gay USA. I'm Ann Northrup. Andy Hum is in London. And
I'm Chris Cooper in the role of Andy Hum.
Thanks for being here, Chris.
Happy to be here, Ann. We are in the middle of the Democratic National Convention right now.
We are. We tape on Wednesday afternoon, so we can bring you up to date as far as Wednesday in the Democratic Convention and finalize what we thought of the Republican convention, because we didn't get to finish that last week.
So in that vein, the Democrats are emphasizing LGBTQ rights in a way that perhaps we did not see last week.
Yes, although it has been the parade to a small extent of the closeted lesbians at the Democratic convention, as well as many out LGBT people, which we'll tell you more about. Meanwhile, Trump did wind up the Republican convention with a claim that he'll protect the LGBTQ community from ISIS.
Well, North Carolina has lost the NBA All-Star game. The NBA pulled it because of their HB2 anti-gay, anti-trans law, and we'll tell you about some of the ramifications of that.
Yes, and great that the NBA stepped up and did what they said they would do. Sad news from Mexico, horrifying, where a transgender beauty queen was brutally murdered.
And a possible thaw at the FDA over blood donations from gay men, which have long been banned. They're going to start soliciting comments on possibly changing those rules.
Yeah, very interesting. And a lovely little piece of news for those of you who are in New York City. Next Friday, August 5th, John Waters' second movie called Multiple Maniacs, starring Divine, is being re-released in a new restored version playing at the IFC Theater. We'll give you a few more details about that. But we start with the Democratic Convention, actually before the Democratic Convention, because of course this has been, God, we've had over a year of this. We have a few more months left. But in the run-up to the Democratic Convention, ACT UP activists went to Philadelphia a couple days before the convention opened to demonstrate at Hillary Clinton's headquarters. They are complaining about actually a factor of the famous TPP, Trans-Pacific Partnership? Yes. About drug prices, because while others are worried about American jobs being protected in the TPP and other aspects of that, what AIDS activists are concerned about is that these trade agreements always prop up the U.S. pharmaceutical industry.
So what they do typically, and correct me if I'm wrong, is they restrict the use, restrict other countries from producing their generic versions of the patented drugs that the U.S. pharmaceutical companies have, and that drives up the drug prices around the world.
International agreements say that poor countries have a legal right to use the generic versions of these drugs. But the U.S., for many years, we were demonstrating against Al Gore for this in his presidential campaign, 16 years ago. What the U.S. does is it writes these clauses into these trade agreements that say, in spite of the World Trade Organization rules or the World Health Organization rules that allow poor countries to get access to generic versions of drugs, we are saying that if you want to do these trade agreements with us, you must respect the patent rights of these pharmaceutical companies and pay higher prices for the brand name versions of these drugs and not get access to the generic versions. So ACT UP and colleagues went to Philadelphia to Hillary Clinton headquarters 2 days before the opening of the Republican convention to demonstrate in favor of access to generic drugs instead of this clause in the TPP agreement. Whether anyone pays attention to that, I don't know, but there is a little warming of the heart of AIDS activists when people complain about these trade agreements.
Yeah, they've been in place, as you said, for a long time, and it's an issue for developing countries.
So then the other thing that happened before the convention opened was Hillary Clinton going to Orlando, Florida, to the Pulse nightclub to meet with survivors of the massacre and relatives of those who were killed, to meet with first responders, and to lay flowers at the memorial that has been created outside spontaneously. I watched some of her roundtable meeting with the first responders. It was classic listening, Hillary.
I was going to say, I did not see it, but I heard that she was singled out for doing more listening than anything else.
Well, it's an admirable quality. We'll get into how much we agree or disagree with Hillary on any number of things, but her ability to go into a situation and appear to listen to people and absorb what they are saying to her, to solicit that kind of input and then turn it into whatever reaction she has. She did it with, of course, the World Trade Center bombing when she was a senator from New York.
Well, she did it when she was running for the Senate from New York because she lived here for all of 15 minutes.
Exactly.
So her big thing when she was running for senator was to go around the state and do these listening tours where she was all about just listening to what people had to say.
And I think she has used that same formula with the Black Lives Matter organization and the mothers of the movement who appeared on stage at the convention this week, giving them the chance to have a voice and to speak for themselves. What you see from the Republicans more so is Trump getting up and pontificating.
Right.
And it's just a different approach. Whether, you know, what that turns into is another question, but it's an interesting difference in their style.
But Anne, you are skipping perhaps the most important development before the convention, which is that Hillary Clinton picked her running mate, Tim Kaine.
Exactly.
That was on Thursday, I guess, that it was tweeted out, and I'm sorry to say that
Friday.
Was it on Friday?
Yes, because Trump was still to speak
on Thursday.
Oh, that's
right. Correct. So she tweeted it out on Friday.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to say that from my perspective, the Tim and Tim Kaine stands for timidity, at least on gay and lesbian issues. He's very much like Hillary in terms of being a very, very latecomer to same-sex marriage, and just sort of like hemming and hawing and, you know, kind of supporting us when he had to in half measures. You know, we can run down the list of some of the things he's done and hasn't done.
My first impression was that Hillary had done the same thing that Barack Obama did, that they are both such, idiosyncratic picks as president. First African-American man as president, first woman as president, that they both went to a very vanilla kind of vice presidential pick in Joe Biden and Tim Kaine. Now, Joe Biden, I think, has grown in the role, but he, you know, don't forget he's a guy who prosecuted in, figuratively, Anita Hill, and had a lot of more conservative leanings in his youth and has progressed as a progressive. Tim Kaine, well, here's what I wrote about Dan about him on LGBT issues. 13 years ago, when the Massachusetts court decided for legalization of same-sex marriage, the first state to legalize it, he condemned it. He was against the action of the court. In 2006, as governor of Virginia, he was in favor of and sort of had mixed feelings about an anti-marriage state referendum.
Right. The bill passed the legislature, and he said he was against it, but he signed it anyway.
Yes.
But then he went on to campaign against the referendum. It passed anyway.
He support at that point, he did come out in favor of adoption by same-sex couples, and he extended an executive order put out by the previous governor that had non-discrimination rules for state employment. But it wasn't until 2013 that he fully came out in favor of same-sex marriage, like Hillary. And now, however, he is a co-sponsor of the Equality Act in Congress as a senator.
He's got a 90% rating from the Human Rights Campaign on his on their congressional scorecard.
He has signed amicus briefs to the Supreme Court on getting rid of the Defense of Marriage Act, on legalizing same-sex marriage, and on interpreting the rules on sex discrimination to include sexual orientation.
So his overall record is very much like Hillary's in terms, especially in terms
it's
of same-sex marriage. But he's light years ahead of Mike Pence, Trump's running mate.
Really, night and day. I also, though, want to point out that he has evolved on abortion rules, too, because he describes himself as a very devout Catholic and as someone who was against women's reproductive rights. Signed legislation that imposed a 24-hour waiting period for abortion and financed abstinence-only education in Virginia, you know, really stuff that we do not approve of, and has evolved on that and now speaks of fully supporting women's right to choose.
And you also have to give him credit for being staunchly in favor of gun control all these years
yes.
when the NRA is headquartered in the state that he is governor of Virginia. So, you know, that's something.
So, but I think he is a conservative choice. He's
a conservative choice, not a conservative.
Correct.
He's a moderate Democrat.
A moderate progressive at this point, I would say. But, you know, picked from Virginia because they want to win that state and because it has a Democratic governor who can appoint a Democratic replacement in the Senate for a year until they have an election. All these kinds of things went into play. She could have picked much more progressive people and chose not to, and we'll see how that plays out for her in the election. But it struck me as the same kind of deliberate, you know, straight white man choice that Obama made in picking a vice president in an attempt to sort of soften the big change they were asking the American people to make.
Well, and also considering that the demographic polling shows that Hillary's biggest problem is with straight white men. In the general, she wants to pull as many of those into her camp as she can pick off. And, you know, Tim Kaine possibly helps her do that.
Well, then the question is always, so do you try to go get those guys who are generally not on your side? Or do you try to draw out your base by, in fact, picking someone more progressive who will excite the base who you need to go vote? We'll see. We'll see in November where that plays out. So meanwhile, the convention itself, you know, the Democratic platform is just pro-LGBT throughout, completely, totally pro-LGBT across the board. And of course, Hillary's campaign manager is Robbie Mook, who is a young out gay man who has now been all over TV in very open and forthright ways. My reference to the closeted lesbians are, of course, that Donna Brazile has now taken over the Democratic National Committee.
Less than forthright.
You know, but she had a great energy the first night. I don't, she's clearly excited by this, but she is, unfortunately, someone who does not speak openly about her sexual orientation.
Not anymore, she used to.
Well, she was on the board of the Millennium March about 15 years ago. I don't know that she ever spoke openly about being a lesbian, but she's been involved in some events. And you know, there will be viewers who say to us, why are you always trying to out people, and why can't you let people come out on their own schedule? Because you're a public figure and you're a role model, and because there are, you know, as Hillary Clinton talks about the importance of herself as a role model for young girls,
yep.
We want public figures, not private people, by all means, make your own decisions. But public figures, we think, have a responsibility to be honest about who they are as a way to display that you can live your life openly and honestly. And I guess we assume they have more safety in that than perhaps someone who is less of a public figure.
So who were some of the other closeted lesbians?
Barbara Mikulski. Who placed Hillary's name in nomination. She's 80 years old now. She's retiring from the Senate. I had a confrontation with her years ago when she voted for the Defense of Marriage Act. You do not, as a closet case, get to vote for the Defense of Marriage Act. So I did confront her publicly about that. And she ran out of the room at Barnes & Noble, where she was trying to sell a book she'd written. So it discourages me to see people who I know are LGBT, who are public figures, who are not talking about it. But on the other hand, you have Tammy Baldwin, a proud, out, wonderful lesbian senator from Wisconsin. You also had an ex-Marine, Kristen Kavanaugh, speaking to the convention, and all these lists of people they have. Chad Griffin of the Human Rights Campaign is scheduled to speak tomorrow night as we tape, along with a trans woman who is an HRC official, who is Sarah McBride, who is scheduled to be right up there on the podium speaking tomorrow night.
And that will be a first for national conventions, won't it?
Absolutely. So that is all terrific. Lee Daniels is scheduled to speak tonight, the terrific director and creator of Empire, and an out gay man, father to one, two kids. I've lost track.
Well, can I just say the celebrity factor in the Democratic convention, and we're only halfway through, compared to the celebrity factor at the Republican convention?
Yeah.
It's a little bit of overkill, actually. When I was sitting there last night, I'm like, Jesus, people, you're going to scare all the viewers away. They're going to say this just confirms the liberal Hollywood bias of the Democratic Party, because it was just dripping with stars and celebrities.
Well, all I would say is that if people are just watching an hour of the convention at 10 p.m. on the major networks, maybe they're not getting quite so overwhelmed, and anything is a relief from seeing
Scott Baio
and who is the other one?
I know. The has-been from soap operas. From Italy.
Antonio Sabato.
Thank you.
I can only think of him as the Calvin Klein underwear model. But also scheduled for the Democrats, and this is after we are taping, is survivors of the Pulse massacre and family members of those murdered and people associated with that. And I think I was quite moved watching the Democratic convention last night, Tuesday night, with the parade of people who represent the mothers. I thought were just stunning, of young black men and women who had been murdered by police and others. I just thought that was really moving and important to give them a voice like that.
I was brought nearly to tears by Michelle Obama on the first night
Absolutely.
Of the convention. She had me just howling with delight and pleasure, and just how it was such a fantastic speech.
Mm-hmm. And of course, virtually every speaker at the Democratic convention is including us on their list of people to be concerned about. 11.5% of the delegates, according to NBC, are LGBT. There are 28 out trans delegates at the Democratic convention. Let's see what else. They have gender neutral bathrooms. They've taken some women's bathrooms because they wanted ones that didn't have urinals, but ones with multiple stalls. There's a videotape online of I don't know that we want cameras in the bathrooms, but in an inoffensive way, they very quickly just sort of did a quick pass through the bathroom. And there are like 20 stalls and men and women coming and going and people of all gender identities and whatever. And people are slightly taken aback, but it's labeled gender-neutral bathroom, and people are using the bathroom.
When I was in college, and I won't say how long ago that was, but it was a long time ago, I shared a bathroom with women in
yes.
our dorm. So,
yes.
you know, what's the big deal?
And another celebrity who spoke, the former NBA player Jason Collins, who told a story about how he had come out to Bill and Hillary personally before he was publicly out on the cover of Sports Illustrated or whatever. So that was an interesting story.
All right. Are we ready to backtrack to the Republicans?
I think so.
All right. Let's talk about them.
Okay. Well, before we get to the Trump speech, which I do want to get to and discuss at some length, but I want to run through a couple of things. Ben Carson said transgender people don't exist. And Orrin Hatch disagreed with him and said, no, you know, they're human beings and they're fine. Ted Cruz claimed he was for freedom for straight and gay to live as they please. This is a man who is called the Supreme Court traitors for legalizing same-sex marriage.
That's just code for Christians should be able to discriminate against lesbians and gays. That's all it is code for.
Yes, yes. Let's see, what else? Oh, there was a Gays for Trump party.
With scantily clad young men.
And white nationalists, and anti-Islamists, and the Dutch gay fascist leader, Geert Wilders. Mm-hmm. It was a horror show.
LGBT has become the fig leaf for the Republican convention. They would say it in a speech, and I counted a couple of people who said it in various speeches and in various contexts, and it was just a way for them to present the image of, no, we don't hate these people, no, we're not trying to take away their rights, when everything they do and everything they're advocating for is about taking away our rights. So it's just a fig leaf. They just throw the words out there, and you know, it used to be, I mean, Bill Clinton actually started off the same way. He didn't necessarily do much, but he would include us in what he said, and that was the fig leaf that we would get all excited about, and we'd be like, wow, he really, really loves us. Well, you know what, that was, what, 25, 30 years ago? It doesn't work anymore.
Well,
you know?
It's really interesting that we are that device, that we've gotten to a point in time where such a large part of the population across the spectrum sees lip service to us as a positive. That even the Republicans will give that lip service, whether or not they're following through on our behalf, but they feel a need and feel that it helps them to say positive things about us. Now, you have only to look at their platform and at their actions to know that it is lip service, but they do, they say positive things. And they put Peter Thiel on the stage, the founder of PayPal.
I missed that speech.
Oh, I saw it.
Oh, please. Tell me all about it.
Well, first of all, he's a little strange in his affect. He seemed a little too nervous and quick and was seemed not to be comfortable with speaking publicly. He wasn't relaxed. He was rushing through. Now, I thought the Trump boys were sort of rushing through their speeches, too. But he was really rushing through, and he did this thing where he said, you know, I'm proud to be gay, I'm proud to be a Republican, I'm proud to be American. Fine. And then he sort of said to the crowd, you should not waste time on stupid social issues like what bathrooms people use. Who cares, he says. Some delegate was, and people applauded mm-hmm. and cheered. Mm-hmm. But some delegate was interviewed later who said, I care. So she was not buying that. But the, you know, when the impulse from the speaker's podium is to lead them to this who cares kind of attitude, then everybody sort of applauds because that's what they're expected to do. But meanwhile, they're still fighting against marriage. They still want the right to same-sex marriage repealed. They want conversion therapy applauded and legalized. They want people to be able to discriminate.
This is all in the platform.
It is. They want people to be able to discriminate in any business, any business, you know, it's if you personally have a religious objection to gay people, we've heard last week you're allowed not to bake a birthday cake. Not a wedding cake, a birthday cake.
It's the Kim Davis rule.
Oh my God. So we're not buying that kind of rhetoric.
Well, Trump also got up there and he's been doing this on the campaign trail too. He's trying to spin himself as the protector, as you mentioned at the top of the show, as the protector of LGBT people, because he's the one who's going to stop ISIS and ISIS kills us. And forget all this other nonsense. What really matters is I'm going to save your life and Hillary's not going to do that. That's the way he's spinning.
Well, let's let him speak for himself. Let's show the video of where we came up in his speech on the closing night of the Republican convention, which some people thought was great, and we will dissect and break down after we show you this.
Only weeks ago in Orlando, Florida, 49 wonderful Americans were savagely murdered by an Islamic terrorist. This time, the terrorists targeted LGBTQ community. No good. And we're going to stop it. President, I will do everything in my power to protect our LGBTQ citizens from the violence and oppression of a hateful foreign ideology. Believe me. And I have to say, as a Republican, it is so nice to hear you cheering for what I just said. Thank you.
Okay, number one, they're cheering against ISIS and against Muslims, and that's the part they're cheering for. The LGBTQ, you could have put anything in that slot, and they would have been cheering because you said, we're going to stop ISIS, and that's all they really cared about, number one. And I've lost my second point. Take it in.
Okay. I'm going to say that I think that Donald Trump and the Republicans at that convention think they are LGBTQ friendly. I don't think they are, but I will give them credit for thinking they are. And I do think they were applauding that line, and that he was right to thank them for applauding that line, because that's their self-image. It is completely opposite to what they are doing, but that, I think, is their self-image.
I will say this about Trump. I don't know that Trump has any sort of animus towards gay people.
I think he thinks he doesn't have any animus.
I think his character flaw is that he's willing to go along with the people who do.
All right, here is my first question to Donald Trump. When you said LGBTQ, what did the Q stand for? I don't think he knows. And I don't think he would understand a discussion of whether it's queer or questioning, nor would he understand that sometimes people say LGBTQQ to cover both those bases.
I think also when he said, you know, 49 wonderful Americans, I think that was just plain pandering.
Well, some of them weren't Americans in the first place. And maybe if we broke that down for him, he'd have a different opinion. No, I think he really thinks he's gay friendly. I think he, you know, he, Mar-a-Lago, when he bought it, was specifically opened as a non-discriminatory club. I'm sure he knows many gay people.
He was pals with Roy Cohn.
Oh my God, yes. Roy Cohn was his mentor. But you know, Roy Cohn, I am not a homosexual. Because homosexuals are people without power, and I am not without power. That's from Angels in America. Mm. I don't know whether he actually said that. But I think Trump sees himself as friendly to the LGBT community. Now, here's the problem. He went out the next morning at a press conference and promised to appoint Supreme Court judges who were as close as possible to our beloved Scalia. I don't think that's pro-LGBT. He says he's in favor of North Carolina's HB2. He has specifically supported HB2 in North Carolina. He is in favor of states having the power to make their own decisions on religious freedom laws, exemptions to discriminate.
His running mate is Mike Pence, which underscores exactly those points.
Exactly. So,
To me, this takes it back to the convention where he said, I'm going to protect you from a hateful foreign, I'm going to protect our LGBTQ citizens from a hateful foreign ideology. What he won't do is protect us from a hateful domestic ideology.
Bingo.
He'll actually buy into that.
Exactly, and it is because, you know, I've seen so many politicians for so many years purport to support us or purport to support some progressive ideology, but when it comes down to getting elected or who is going to give them the money to continue or keeping their job, it always means they sell us out in the end. And Donald Trump is selling us out for the support of the evangelical community. Mike Pence is a sop to the evangelical community. Tony Perkins wrote the Republican platform. Trump met here in New York just a few weeks ago with 50 of the most important leaders of the evangelical movement. He has refused to meet with AIDS activists or people working on AIDS organizations or on AIDS issues. He has refused to announce an opinion about the Equality Act in Congress. Guess what? He's not going to support it. Donald Trump, to be elected, to stay in office, will side with the evangelical right wing. I say that based on experience and on the experience of what he specifically has done, as well as all the other politicians over the years.
Now, all of that said, and I don't mean to suggest in any way that it's not night and day between the Republican nominees and the Democratic nominees, but should Hillary Clinton and her running mate Tim Kaine get into office, we're going to have to watch them like a hawk, because they too, you know, their commitment is soft. It's not, they're not against us, but their commitment is soft, and if we don't keep our eyes on them and keep the pressure on them to deliver on a progressive agenda, they've already thrown us under the bus in the first Clinton administration. It could happen again.
And even if they are totally devoted to us, if we don't have a Congress that is on our side, we're dead in the water anyway. So really what it always comes back to is, who are we going to elect to the United States Senate and the House of Representatives? Because what has become clear over the years is that they really do have the upper hand, and it's crucially important that we investigate who's running for office and hold them accountable and lobby them and make sure that we elect people to those offices who are going to be open to our point of view.
And for just one second, I have to channel Andy Hum and say it's not just about the federal elections, it's not just about the presidency and the Congress. We've also got to pay so much more attention to what's going on in our states, because that's where a lot of the Republican takeover has happened. It's why a lot of the redistricting took place that allowed the Republicans to get a hold on the National Congress in a way that is going to take us decades to pry loose. So we've got to pay attention to the states as well.
Mike Pence, puppet of the Koch brothers.
Yep.
This is all about getting access to their money and influence. Trump also went out the next morning in this same press conference where he talked about the beloved Antonin Scalia. He talked about one of his highest priorities being repealing some law from the Johnson administration, and I haven't researched it, so I'm not sure that he's right about this. But he wants to repeal any law that restricts the political speech of churches.
Oy.
And what that means, it's not just about preachers standing up in pulpits. It's about then the right wing being able to funnel money through churches, because mm-hmm. as we know from Citizens United, money is speech. And if the right wing can give money to churches who can then use it on political campaigns, that is a way for them to, launder their money into campaigns. So that is a terrible thing for him to propose. Now, we told you last week that in anticipation of the Republican convention, Cleveland City Council had passed an ordinance expanding gender identity protections for bathroom use, just a little slap in the face of the Republicans. And sure enough, the mayor signed that ordinance just before the Republican convention opened. The other little piece of news that came out of Cleveland was that, as we see at all events like this, the number of closeted married men in town using Grindr to hire male escorts escalated.
And one tiny footnote, a street artist named Plastic Jesus built a concrete wall around Donald Trump's Star of Fame on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
That was cute.
With little barbed wire on top.
But I have to say, the scariest thing I saw in convention coverage was someone who went out and interviewed people on the street, young men and women, asking them about the prospect of a woman president. Against it.
Really?
Oh, shocking. Shocking, the number of people on the street who said, oh, we don't want a woman as president.
Yeah, well, you know, we've had 8 years of finding out what they think of a black man as president.
Exactly. So we're in for a doozy this fall. Can we move on from the conventions?
Yes.
We will be wrapping up comments and news from the Democratic convention next week, because as we said, we're taping on Wednesday afternoon, so half of it lies before us, and we'll catch up with that next week. All right, on to other news.
Do you want to stick with national, or do you want to talk about the Mexican?
No, I think we will do national news, and we'll start in North Carolina, where the NBA, the National Basketball Association, has followed through on its pledge to hold firm against the HB2 law, which takes away all non-discrimination laws that cover LGBT people. Tells trans people they cannot use the bathroom that corresponds with their current gender identity, stops people from suing for non-discrimination, although they made a tiny adjustment in that. It's a heinous law, and the NBA said, you know, we're not on board with that, and so we're not going to allow our big event to take place in Charlotte, North Carolina next year. We are withdrawing the 2017 All-Star Game. We're going to move it maybe to New Orleans. They're investigating. And that's $100 million worth of business they're taking out of North Carolina.
North Carolina's governor, Pat McCrory, is hopping mad. He said the sports and entertainment elite had misrepresented our laws and maligned the people of North Carolina. And he said that American families should be on notice that the selective corporate elite, there's that word again, are imposing their political will on communities in which they do business, thus bypassing the democratic and legal process.
It's just fascinating how they twist their language into pretzels on this.
Newsflash, Pat, it's just a business exercising its right to do business as it sees fit.
Which is to not discriminate.
Exactly.
Turner Sports, which carries NBA games, and Nike, a major sponsor of the NBA, both supported the NBA's decision to pull out of North Carolina. The famous Duke University coach, Mike Krzyzewski, said it's an embarrassing bill, HB2, and the North Carolina state coach said he's appalled. The ACC, I've now forgotten what that's, Atlantic Coast Conference, which is the college division that includes North Carolina, says they are rethinking their scheduling of various tournament games for them there next year, although they haven't made a final decision.
But golf's PGA championship is staying in Charlotte.
Not the PGA championship, but the PGA of America, which holds several tournaments in North Carolina, says they're not moving any of them. They have a rationale.
Our tournaments, says the 2017 PGA Championship will remain in Quail Hollow Club in Charlotte.
Okay. I stand corrected. I didn't know the PGA next year was at Quail Hollow.
But the PGA Tour is also not moving any of its...
No, because they say, here's their explanation. We hold our tournaments at private clubs, and private clubs are not affected by this law, only public facilities. So we intend to make our tournaments friendly to all patrons, and that's why we can stay. Now, that's a rationalization.
Nice dodge.
They hope the law will change. They're against the law. They agree, but they're not moving anything yet. The federal trial on the law, because the Justice Department and various people from our side are suing the state to overturn the HB2 law, that federal trial is going to start on November 14th. We'll follow that, of course. Let's see, anything else from North Carolina? Oh, the NCAA also has new rules in place that... Any place that wants to hold an NCAA tournament for the March Madness, whole month of tournaments, has to prove that it is not a site that has discriminatory laws in place.
So when you say not the site, specifically the venue?
No, the city.
The city,
or town.
I see.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we'll see. In the same vein, in Maryland, a young trans man, 14 years old, maybe I should call him a boy, is suing the Talbot County Public Schools for bathroom and locker room access in St. Michael's, Maryland, which is a fairly rural and conservative place.
And in Wisconsin, a young trans student named Ashton Whitaker is suing his school district because they want the trans students to wear bright green wristbands to identify themselves.
Yeah, where have we heard of things like that before?
Exactly.
In West Virginia, they're trying to deal with a horrible flood they had a few weeks ago, so they're in emergency session to deal with flood relief. But they're gonna stick in an anti-transgender bill in the midst of their debates over flood relief.
Oh, thank goodness.
The ACLU and a trans prison nurse have filed a complaint with the Iowa Department of Corrections to let him use the men's bathroom and locker room. He also gets no coverage for health care from Iowa. And let's see, do I have any other? Oh, in Oregon, remember, you know, these right wingers who have occupied various public lands and claimed them?
They took over the wildlife refuge.
Yes, exactly. That's exactly right. So one of them, David Fry, who's in jail, who claims he was just there to videotape the whole thing, he's in jail. Others are out. He's like the last one in jail. And he is now saying he has gender dysphoria and he wants treatment for that.
That should go over well with his pals.
Yeah, exactly.
We haven't talked about a new study speaking of all these transgender students, that says that LGBTQ students feel safer at schools when there are gay straight alliances there. Now, you know, this probably is not a shock, but, you know, it's good to have it quantified.
Well, it's a study that comes out of Vanderbilt University, and what they did was they did a meta-analysis of 15 studies involving 63,000 students across the country and found that students actually are safer and less bullied in schools that have gay straight alliances, which is great news. Now, it raises the question what they're doing at Pepperdine University in California. We've been following for some months the great escalation in requests by religiously affiliated universities for exemptions from non-discrimination laws. Ever since the federal government started interpreting non-discrimination laws as including gender identity and sexual orientation, all these universities have been saying, oh, wait a minute, I want a waiver. The law says I can have a waiver if I'm a religious school. Now that I see you're actually going to enforce this, I want a waiver. And so we went from like three or four universities a year to dozens now requesting these waivers. And Pepperdine was one of the early ones because they are, you know, that's where Ken Starr was teaching before he then went to Baylor and was kicked out for not doing enough about the football team sexually assaulting women after he prosecuted Bill Clinton. But Pepperdine is a very religiously oriented school, and they had a waiver, and they have now asked to give up the waiver. And everybody's sort of scratching their head and saying, why would Pepperdine do this? And no one's figured it out yet, except that they're in California, and California is about to pass laws that kind of penalize universities that get these waivers. They penalize them with state funding being dropped. So we're going to see if anyone actually figures out whether Pepperdine has that in mind or whether they've had a change of heart. Who knows? But we'll follow that. The Masterpiece Cake Shop in Colorado is appealing to the Supreme Court of the United States to overturn the laws that have said, all the court rulings that have said, yes, they discriminated against a gay couple when they refused to bake a wedding cake for them because Colorado has a non-discrimination law. So they're not giving up. And in Kansas, a federal judge says that the state must follow the law and give equal benefits to married same-sex couples that they do to opposite-sex couples, including putting the names of both the parents on a birth certificate. And the court says they're going to monitor the state for 3 years to make sure they do follow through. Okay. In Mississippi, Robbie Kaplan, our great lawyer, who sure. lesbian lawyer who won the Edie Windsor overturning the Defense of Marriage Act. She got, speaking of people uncovering emails, she got the emails around the Mississippi heinous HB 1523, the extensive religious freedom law there. And it turns out, of course, that the right-wing Alliance Defending Freedom wrote the law for the legislature and wrote the governor's signing statement of the law.
No shock there.
In case you were wondering who's controlling things. And Andy wants us to make a correction because he said last week that the Ku Klux Klan was started in Philadelphia, Mississippi. And a viewer wrote to say that, no, it was founded in Pulaski, Tennessee. In Orlando, they held a one-night benefit performance of Fun Home, the Alison Bechdel lesbian play that
Which
won the Pulitzer Prize.
Closing soon here on Broadway.
It is, and you should see it if you haven't. But the whole cast went down to Florida to do this one-night benefit, and the creators, there were Lisa Crone, Gene Tesori, all the people associated with creating it. Did a talk back with the audience, and they raised $100,000 in one night for the Orlando survivors and families of those massacred. Actually, and for Equality Florida, the statewide group there. A couple of stories of violence in New York City, a couple of
one in Hell's Kitchen, one in Midtown, unfortunately. You think you're safe here, but you're not. There was a patron who left vodka soda, a gay bar in Hell's Kitchen. He ended up with a broken leg, 25-year-old man, after he was chased down the street by men shouting anti-gay slurs and was physically assaulted. And then after that in Midtown, or actually before that, on July 11th, there was an incident of two men who were on 33rd Street and 8th Avenue when an individual began shouting homophobic slurs at them and threatened them with a box cutter. So, yeah, even here in New York City, which is supposedly liberal bastion of the country, you got to worry about it.
And in Mississippi, back to Mississippi, in a town called St. Martin, a trans woman, Dee Wiggum, 25 years old and a registered nurse, was murdered at a Best Western hotel by a Navy seaman, 20 years old. They have video of him leaving the hotel, I should say, allegedly by him. It's the 14th documented murder by a of a trans woman this year. And I was at a demonstration last weekend with Gays Against Guns at the Reebok store on Fifth Avenue. Reebok, with the CrossFit organization, they run some national competition. What are they giving away? Guns. They're giving away guns. Glock handguns. So we there was a demonstration at a couple of Reebok stores. They are now no longer publicizing the giving away of the guns. We're not sure whether they are actually doing it yet.
But unfortunately, all these tales of violence take us to Mexico.
Yes.
Where there was a transgender beauty pageant winner, contestant named Paulette Gonzalez. She disappeared in early June on a visit to a friend in a town called Irapuato, and they found her charred body, her charred remains, in Celaya, Mexico.
Terrible. They had to do a DNA test to ID her because she was burned so completely over her body.
They have not classified this as a hate crime just yet. They're investigating several possibilities.
Yeah, in London, a guy named Stephen Port is now going on trial in October for seducing online, drugging, and murdering four men. He's been charged with attacks on eight more, poisoning them with GHB, raping them, assaulting them.
Yeah, I have to admit that I think the headline on this is a little misleading, because it seems like he was set out to kill people. And I think the way I read the story was that he was drugging them with GHB so he could rape them. Which is not any better. But that four of them died from the GHB overdose, and then he dumped the body. bodies.
Yeah, let's say he wasn't intimidated by the fact that some of them died. He went right on doing it.
Exactly.
In Tanzania, in an attempt to stop all homosexuality, which is illegal in Tanzania, they have banned lubricant. People have crazy ideas. In Romania, we previewed this for you last week, the Constitutional Court has decided that the right wing there can ask Parliament to change the law and outlaw same-sex marriage. They need a two-thirds vote there to do it. LGBT activists demonstrated against this. The court received briefs on this issue from Liberty Counsel and Alliance Defending Freedom in the United States. You'd think they have better things to do than go to Romania file court briefs.
They don't. They lose so consistently here in the States. These are the only venues where they can score their victories.
Well, they're writing laws in Mississippi.
Well, and a little bit better news. We need some good news after all that. In Canada, British Columbia is going to include transgender rights into their human rights code, specifically explicit language on protecting transgender people. baseball, so that's great.
Yes, we'll hopscotch quickly through this because we're running out of time. Slovenia, the constitutional court there refused to allow signature gathering for a referendum to stop the Civil Partnership Act from taking effect next February. That's good news. And the Cayman Islands Immigration Appeals Tribunal has said that the Cayman Islands has to treat married same-sex couples from elsewhere. They have to be treated equally to opposite-sex couples. Unfortunately, you still can't get married in the Cayman Islands, but if you're married elsewhere, supposedly you're treated the same.
Meanwhile, in Venezuela, where they are trying to get marriage equality, and the Supreme Court there seems to be leaning towards it, there's been a challenge filed by the right wing that the Supreme Court there has said they will consider. So we will see what happens there.
And Andy's news from England. In Brighton, England, some schoolboys on a hot day wore shorts to school and were told they had to change, so they came back the next day in the school uniform, skirts. Good for them. Thank you. All right, AIDS news. Actually, the big headline in AIDS news this week is that the Food and Drug Administration, which controls these things, has published a request in the Federal Register for public comment on ways to update the blood donation rules, because they got so it used to be totally illegal for you to donate blood if you were a man who had sex with another man in the last, I think, 17 years, maybe even longer. Then last year they said, all right, you don't like us doing that. The Red Cross is against that. If you've been abstinent for a year, you can donate blood. Well, that's not a solution to anything.
Right.
So now they're saying, all right, maybe we could move to an actual risk-based formula instead of a stereotypical, labeling stigma kind of formula. So it'll be very interesting to see how that proceeds.
And this is in response to pressure from congressional Democrats. So,
and the fact that a lot of people lined up to donate blood after the Orlando massacre and couldn't do it because they didn't meet the FDA rules. They're protesting at the International AIDS Conference in Durban, South Africa, about not enough access to generic drugs.
There's a meningitis outbreak in Los Angeles County, and they're specifically asking gay men to get vaccinated because 10 of the 19 cases have been in gay men. So this is in Los Angeles County.
And HRC has worked with Walgreens to create a guide to serving LGBTQ customers and patients and distributed that to 70,000 healthcare professionals.
All right.
Entertainment news. Well, I'm excited because next Friday, August 5th, the second film that John Waters ever made has been restored and is opening at the IFC Theater here in Manhattan. 1970, Multiple Maniacs with Divine, set, of course, in Baltimore. John Waters calls it a celluloid atrocity, and he made it, and he's calling it restored, reviled, revolting. Multiple Maniacs at the IFC.
And I saw the new Star Trek movie, Star Trek Beyond, which I know Ann and Andy talked about recently, because Mr. Sulu, the helmsman of the Starship Enterprise, was revealed as gay in this movie. It's done in a very organic way, very natural. The movie itself is a lot of fun. It's not great, but it's a good fun summer popcorn movie. Some beautiful design in it. The villain is kind of generic, but all in a little bit predictable. But all in all, a good experience, good film-going experience.
Opening this weekend in Los Angeles, Women He's Undressed, about the famous three-time Oscar-winning costume designer Ori Kelly. Very out gay, lived with Cary Grant when they were both young in New York, and very cranky about Cary, who was not who certainly was not out about who he was. Very interesting movie, Women He's Undressed, and coming on DVD and video on demand too. And Monday, August 1st, 7:30, a benefit at the Eagle for Orlando, a stage reading of Doric Wilson's The West Street Gang, written in 1977 about the spike. And that is it. And thank you, Chris.
My pleasure, Ann.
And Andy will be back next week, and we'll see you then.